Good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming. It's my night to introduce the visiting alumnus, who is Theo Turpin, who graduated in 2008. When I got the job, you transferred onto the course from LCC. This is kind of an interesting history in terms of how one gets through life generally. Theo was studying film at LCC and transferred onto the drawing course. And then you did photography on the drawing course, mostly, and sculpture. Actually you did drawing after you graduated from the course. So, you know, in terms of conventional behavior, he kind of fits, right? So he finished the course and has been working as an artist, living locally ever since, but doing residencies and showing all over. So he's done Bold Tendencies. He installed a piece of work in that first Bold Tendencies, which was 2009, yeah. He did a very, very prestigious residency at the Palais de Tokyo in Paris 2 years ago. He's just completed a residency in Geneva, and you would think, why would he need to do any more with education? But no, he is now doing an MFA at Goldsmiths. So I don't know what you're going to talk about, but it might be interesting to relate your development of your work outside the institution and the decision to go back in. I think that might be interesting for people to hear. So are you happy for people to wait till the end and ask questions?
Yeah, or I mean, is anything burning?
Yeah, just stick your hand up or shout out, I totally disagree, or whatever. Or what's, how big is it? How long did that take you to make? Yeah.
How big is it? I like that one more.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Oh, by the way, if you have to leave, gently let that door shut, because it's so annoying. And everybody leaves this way. So, yeah.
Okay, hello. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Kelly, for this lovely introduction. It's very sweet. You missed out all of the drinking stories and everything like that. Okay, so yeah, so I thought I would do a bit of a kind of slideshow and show some works and things to. And not talk too much about specific stuff, but specific works, but kind of go through to identify some kind of key things. And it also kind of runs mildly chronologically, or it at least ends now, which kind of makes sense. I work across mediums, but the kind of central theme that runs through all the work is a kind of search for to comprehend and reuse certain linguistic constructs using languages or appropriating and remixing them as a way to kind of try to construct and deconstruct the world around us. General cultural languages. So I thought I'd begin by talking about this series of works because it displays this quite well. And also it's kind of romantic, which relates to the piece that is in the corridor downstairs. So this is from a series of works, a series of photographs called An Epitaph. The works take the Victorian language of flowers, or floriography, as the kind of construct. And the Victorian language of flowers is a kind of romantic construct in a period of a slightly conservative society, which allowed people to kind of communicate varying degrees of romantic intention to each other in a kind of slightly, kind of like low-key way. And for these works, I selected flowers which had slightly unromantic meanings. And then I, for example, this, the meaning of the flower is disdain. So I took the meaning and rework it into a sentence which is maybe could be commonly used or as a play on words, and represented the two together. All the flowers are re-photographed with this kind of romantic soft tonality. And what I'm kind of interested with here, and you'll see it repeating, is how if you present, how you have a kind of visual comprehension of a cultural symbol, and how that can be altered or abstracted as it sits in relation to the title. How maybe there can be made a moment of distance between you as the viewer and your comprehension of the image. The flower is, as a kind of like a slightly vulgar emotive motif, is something that I have used quite a lot, and I kind of deploy it like a kind of strategy. For example, here, this is, I was asked to do a piece for a Bienale in the southwest of France, and it was in a villa. And the villa was built around kind of like 1800, and it had a kind of typically, at the time, a kind of typically neo-Gothic, kind of aspirational aesthetic. So I made this work, which is called The Triumph of Time and Strength, and the bouquet, the three elements of the bouquet, the gladiola, the poplar, and the laurel, mean triumph of time and strength. And The Triumph of Time over Strength is a quote from the Scottish romantic philosopher Lord Kames, from a treatise he wrote about gardening, and he said that if you were to construct a ruin in your garden, like a faux ruin, it should be near Gothic, because it showed the triumph of time over strength, as opposed to neoclassical, which would show the triumph of vulgarity of a sense. And during the 3 months of the show, a florist came every week to change the bouquet and threw the dead ones on the floor next to it. So it also was a literal triumph of time over strength. And from neo-Gothic into classical and back to the languages, one of the languages I work with a lot is architecture. Because I'm very interested in this kind of dynamic that you have on the one hand of a linguistic which is used for control or for to depict power, and the fact that obviously people exist within it, and that there is a kind of counter, like a modernist rhetoric around a kind of emancipatory humanistic. Use of the language. So this is a piece I made for Palais de Tokyo in 2013. It's called Reinserting the Human in the Human Myth. And the piece itself is a floor vinyl, which is actually, it's like a type of vinyl that you only really use for adverts, like you see them in supermarkets and stuff, like kind of like buy Coca-Cola, you know, like a non-slip floor vinyl. And for the work, I asked French choreographer and dancer, contemporary dancer, Rémy Héritier, to reinterpret a series of key classical symbols within architecture. So the, like the arcade, the Corinthian columns, the arch and the pediment. And he reinterpreted them from drawings by Palladio. Revivalist classic architect. And then the work sits with this text, which is kind of like a prompt for the possibility of engaging within this linguistic, and particularly with this language within this institution, which itself is a kind of monumental, kind of fascist building. So this relationship between people, cultural mythology and power is something that I try to explore in numerous works, but I thought I would just show a shortish, recording a shortish live piece that I made in a national theatre in Valenciennes, which is a work called A Triumphal Reconstruction. I played that for you now. Thank you. Okay. One of the things I think is, well, there's two things I think that are important to talk about, to highlight with this work is, firstly, I guess slightly in connection to the idea of like working and the means in which you work or the medium, is I think it's important, very important to me to try to find forms which allow the possibility for a retranslation of a thing. And the point of a lot of this is about potentiality, kind of narrative potentiality. So in that work that you just saw, kind of, even though it is a kind of like a, an intentionally undramatic piece which uses these like large emotive signifiers. The most important thing about it is its kind of potential. Potential to be activated or continued in some way. And this has always been kind of the major drive in my work. I showed this. This is the piece that was in Bold Tendencies a very long time ago, which is why it has such a nice 70s colour balance. Because the important thing about the work, if the work was a scaffold tower with a staircase that went up to the top, and on the top was a diving board which looked down onto a pool which has a mirror on the top of it. And the important thing in the work is actually the dynamic potential or the narrative potential that exists in the space between the diving board and the pool, because that is where the potentiality happens. That is the narrative, or the narrative focus. And the narrative interest is something that has existed from the point when I studied film, and this kind of filmic potential is a recurring theme and another recurring language. I mean, and it finds its form in numerous ways. For example, in this piece, which is a series of 10 of these triptychs of National Geographic dystopian images, on which there is stamped equilibrium, disequilibrium, new equilibrium, which is basically the narrative theory by Theo Turpin to describe pretty much all Hollywood narratives. And the work is gradiating in colour, so it also has a kind of coded. There is a kind of coded potential in it. And I'm especially interested in the way that this kind of thing manifests itself in film, and in particular in the way that it was used in Hollywood, particularly in the golden era, to create not just narrative structures, but to define a whole kind of cultural mythology, like a whole cultural language. I'm going to show you another much shorter video extract, which is from another piece I did at Palais De Tokyo, which is a performance called Romance as Mythology, or Mythology as Romance. And the piece consists of an edit I did of a film called How the West Was Won, which is one of the last epic, pretty much the last epic Western from the old Hollywood system. And it charts the history of the movement of the non-native peoples from east to west. So I edited all of the monologues, which are all the historic elements, and I cut them into an audio file which plays, and employed actors to come and repeat, live repeat the audio using a techniques of a type of theatre called verbatim theatre, which is a kind of documentary style of theatre, which employs this strategy of live repetition from what's being heard on the headphones as a way to try to introduce a greater authenticity into what it perceives as a kind of middle class realm of the theatre. And so I'll just show a short extract.
Thank you. lines marked on maps. But the names and the marks and the land all had to be one.
One from nature and from primitive man. 5 generations ago, a mere 125 years back, this land was known only as the West, known only to a handful of white men, lonely trappers wandering its fastness in search of beaver. The West, of course, was no smoother than that of true love. Not only the hard hand of nature was against it, but the impediment of war. Trouble of the land smoldered along the Mexican border. Not all Americans were for war, including Congressman Abe Lincoln of Illinois. But a war did break out. And in the end, vast new territories came into the Union, along with their rich Spanish names, Rio Grande, Santa Fe, Albuquerque, El Paso, and most glittering of all, California. Evening of April 6th, 1862. The guns that had roared all day fell silent around a little church called Shiloh Meeting House. Many a man had met his God that Sunday, but not in church. It had been the bloodiest day of the war on the Western Front. In the morning, it looked like a Confederate victory, but by nightfall, no man cared to use the words win or lose. After Shiloh, the South never smiled. Even while North and South were being torn apart, East and West had been drawn together by the Pony Express, the most daring mail route in history. 80 riders were in the saddle of all time, night and day, in all weather. Half of them were in the east, half riding west, between Missouri and Sacramento, carrying mail across country in days instead of months. Unarmed, they wrote to save weight. $5 a letter the mail cost, and on thin paper, too. It was courage, skill, and speed against hostile Indians, bandits, hail, and occasional high water. The coming of railroads brought changing the lands where they passed. Now immense herds of cattle were driven hundreds of miles to meet the lines, bound for markets in the east. Fences went up, cattle trails were barred, and a long and bloody wrangle began between cattlemen and homesteaders. The law was in the hands of whoever could shoot fast and straight, except where there was somebody determined to stand for law. But time was running out for the reckless ones, the desperados, the galloping gunshot boys. As more and more citizens demanded respect for the law and showed themselves ready to fight to uphold it, and the raw new towns that sprung up in the West began to dream of becoming as refined as that one-time hooligan city by the Golden Gate, San Francisco was now respectable. So sophisticated, in fact, it even had mansions up for auction. The West that was won by its pioneers, settlers, adventurers is long gone now. And it is theirs forever. For the left tracks of history that will never be eroded by wind or rain, never plowed under by tractors, never buried in the compost of events. Out of the harsh simplicity of their lives, out of their vitality, their hopes, and their sorrows, grew legends of courage and pride to inspire their children and their children's children. From soil enriched by their blood, out of their fever to explore and build, came lakes where once were burning deserts, came the goods of the earth, mines and wheat fields, orchards and great lumber mills, all the cities of the growing country. Out of their rude settlements, their training posts, came cities to rank among the great ones of the world, all the heritage of the people free to dream, free to act, free to mold their own destiny.
So for me, it's kind of, it's the construct or the language's space editability and usability, which is so fascinating and so important. And the overtones that, that kind of aesthetic can provide alters, or is adjusted by the nature of its manufacture or of its setting, which again kind of goes back to the reason for the varied forms, and is the basic decision that I always, the basic question that I always ask myself before making any work is about the way in which, the form in which it is most ably constructed, and which is basically the one in which it can be edited the best, or remixed the best. So these kind of questions of construct are very big for me. They go kind of hand in hand with this whole kind of mythology, cultural mythology, the validity or the potentially the truth of that. There's something that is explored in these works here, which are called, this is a series called The Hoax, in which I took quotes about construction and semiotics and then reproduced tableaus, these noirish tableaus, in which the meaning again is reconstructed through the elements that are in the photo. I mean, fundamentally, I think I believe that what I want to, what I'm trying to produce or communicate is some kind of bastardized advertising, some kind of communication form which has like a very direct ability but is slightly slightly incomprehensible, but relies on very much the same type of structures and the same type of relationship between image, language and meaning, hopefully finding a space in between where something new can happen. So yeah, the commercial arts and design are a very big influence for me, to such a degree that I, this is from a series called Homage à, which is me just literally hand reproducing an A0 advert, but stripping all of the elements of product and all of the elements of placement out of them, and replacing the text, the tagline for the product with a title of a previous work of mine. So kind of playing on the very nature of the construct of mythologies and the construct of course, my own mythology within that. This text, you will see a lot because it has become, it's basically a hand-copied version of Helvetica, which is important because of the kind of design-driven symbolism of that Swiss font. And yes, it's important because it's in the work that's here today and outside, and it's, you'll see it repeated again. For example, here, this is a series of recent works of soon-to-be freely downloadable desktops for iPhones and computers. It's a series of works, and each one has a different, uses a different copyright-free example of one of the key epochs of ornamentation, juxtaposed against, with a title from one of a series of J.G. Ballard's short stories called The Midland Sands, which is like a kind of future, represents like a future artistic, technological dystopia, potentially. The series themselves are called Distribution, Radiation, Continuity, which according to Owen Jones, who was a Victorian archaeologist, is obsessive about ornamentation. It's one of the key rules if you were to make ornamentation yourself. And that's kind of important, actually, because it calls up a kind of another discourse which is kind of important to talk about, which is one of distribution and the kind of lineage of rules, criticism, critique, and maybe, like in this work, potentially finally protest. This is from a series of protests like placards and banners, which all use film noir titles as protest slogans. And I'm very interested in that kind of lineage of this popular cultural mythology and how that works and how that relates. And this kind of brings me neatly to round to the back to the first slide on flowers. And I thought I would just also talk a little bit about romance within my work, partially because, or quite importantly, because I'm working on it a lot at the moment. And the piece that's here downstairs is a direct product of that, and I thought maybe it's also nice to have a bit of context about that. So for quite a few years, I would talk a lot about the idea of romance as a strategy for engagement, and like the kind of idea of how I use these big signifiers as a way to literally try to kind of force an engagement, or like elicit an engagement with the audience. Because if you have a big engagement, then maybe you can alter the discussion somehow. So I've been talking about this for a long time and using this as a kind of idea and an extension to narrative and to Hollywood and to Victorian flowers and ornamentation and all this type of thing, like that, in relation to architecture and everything. But within the last year or so, I began to expand on that idea to kind of try and gain some greater contextualization. And I began to think a lot about romanticism as a visual language, not just romance. And romanticism is largely considered to be born as a reaction to the Industrial Revolution. And I sort of thought, well, if that was born out of the flames of industry, then you know, maybe we have a similar revolutionary moment, which is a reaction to the digital, in the cloud of the digital. So I entered in, so the piece downstairs is an attempt, which is called Le Romantisme de la Révolution, which is important because it's a kind of an apocryphal protest slogan, which no one, which apparently Les Gens France, who were the French romantics at the time of the French Revolution, would walk the streets of Paris shouting. But no one, but this was just claimed by a single man, and it's not. So it's kind of become a piece of mythology, which cannot be identified or clarified. And so in relation to this, I have begun a larger piece of work, which is a discussion between myself and my friend and philosopher Federico Campagna about the potential for a new romanticism. And I thought I would just kind of end tonight before the, any questions you may have by just reading a small excerpt from that to maybe illustrate what maybe is a revolutionary cry. So yeah, this is a discussion. If you look at older, normally much older, representations of love, it is usually a socially disruptive force. For example, in ancient Greece, Paris kidnapping Helen was not just socially disruptive, it fucks up the entire world of the Trojans. Everybody hates her. Everybody hates her. It's that kind of story. All this great tragedy of Tristram and Isolde, or Lancelot and Guinevere. In these examples, love is seen as the ultimately disruptive social force. This is true to such an extreme that it can actually be connected to ideas of the Dionysian. This is the excess that really truly goes beyond society to the point where it becomes kind of dangerous. I think, though, the contemporary accounts of love, and here's where Romanticism enters sentimentalism, is something that is really not socially disruptive in any way. On the contrary, they are considered as the cornerstone or one of the first products of society. One requirement of social conformism is love, which has to be applied to more than just a person. It has to apply to your job, to McDonald's because you're loving it, and all those kinds of things. I mean, do you have a romance with McDonald's when you're loving it? Do you have a romance with your job if you say, I love my job? Is that romance? Is that a type of return? Well, maybe it is. Because if ontologically what really exists today is only the language of things, the linguistic representation of things, with no pre-existing reality, so society produces language and language produces society. Neither of these things exist in anything other than the linguistic. Then, at that point, return within this ontology remains on that level. There is no other level, no transcendence or anything. So you yourself are a linguistic construct, and you fall in love with your job or McDonald's, which are linguistic constructs as well. But by falling in love with them, you, who still retains a certain aspect of biology, of something that is not just language, redeem yourself, you unify. So conformism, which is the driving force of the 20th and 21st centuries, is this aspect. Conformism is the mysticism of the contemporary age. That's why it's not socially disruptive, but it's the first requirement of society, that you love, because the only thing that you can possibly love is society. Because the only thing you can find with anyone on a dating website is social attributes. Being a cat lover, being a book lover, listening to Michael Jackson. These are entirely social aspects. So that's what you're going to fall in love with. And by falling in love with them, you go back into society. You dissolve. In the contemporary age, when everything is very language heavy, it's an industrial linguistic, or linguistically industrial. Dissolving to that level means that you have become a fully productive and available raw element. Well, in that case, do you think that some kind of romance, in the way that we've been describing it, some kind of new understanding of romance, is exactly what is necessary to break this industrial linguistic? Because it is something without such fixed linguistic ends, because throughout our entire conversation, the return, the nostalgia, we cannot manipulate it entirely, even in the way we're discussing it. Therefore, it falls from being pure linguistic. Absolutely, I mean, to a certain extent, we need a Romeo and Juliet moment, in which it is really and truly reasserted. Of course, again, Romeo and Juliet comes from an archetype, which is prevalent in Greek myths of a similar type. But it's a moment in which love reaffirms a break with this culturally and socially constructed linguistic world, proposes an outside of some sort, and thus proposes a plurality of dimensions which has been completely lost. But love is an unworkable thing, which we can acknowledge, like necessity, and which therefore cannot produce a revolution of any sort. What produces a revolution is something that keeps a foot in both shoes, and that is romance, because romance is, to a certain extent, the rationalization, the turning of necessity and love into a workable thing. We cannot handle love directly, we probably shouldn't, but romance we can. So romance can become semi-revolutionary, in that sense, truly disruptive, but also productive. There you go. Okay, do you have any questions? It's okay if you don't. We can go to the pub, which might be more fun. No? Okay.
I have a question.
Okay.
I'm going to ask you a question.
You always ask questions.
I do. But I'm thinking about, I can't help but think about technology.
Yeah.
And you refer to the Industrial Revolution and then cellulite film. And now we're in a very different age, a different technological revolution. and you mentioned dating websites, and so within a kind of discussion of romance, the distance and the connectedness of technology is something that I think about.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of the it's that which is the prompt for the discursive work, really, which is about, like, I guess I don't have an answer, but there is a question which is, as we, how do we, of course, like, regain some kind of human connected potentiality to redefine some kind of new language, to redefine something, to make, like, a break from the kind of linearity of the linguistic thing, which, of course, all of these technological constructs are very much about the linearity of a kind of semiotic form, you know? And so I think it's very interesting to ask, like, is there a potential for break? Not through the technology, but almost maybe as a against the technology, because maybe that's more interesting. Because, of course, you know, like, the revolution that exists through the technology is often a kind of attempt to reproduce a kind of thing which pre-existed anyway. You know, it's like a kind of, it represents itself like a kind of chameleon form, you know. And I don't actually, I don't claim to have an answer, but I think it's an interesting kind of question.
Are you sort of saying that you think that the irony of the sort of misuse of language on the internet, was sort of repulsively simplified, like on Facebook and things, has sort of made us so that we actually are like that? So, because we grew up and we use it, we use the language like that, now we've actually become that shallow and appalling.
Well, I don't know, but I mean, I think it obviously, it becomes cultural language, doesn't it? So, you know, we rapidly appropriate it and reuse it, and it becomes the norm, and that is, I think, just a thing. Not to say that we don't have potential, like, obviously, as individuals beyond that norm.
You're talking about in the field of revolution, of course, ISIS and, of course, those groups use the internet unbelievably cleverly for their revolution. Mm. Well, if you call it
that's another.
But I mean, I know that's a completely different issue. But then that makes all this discussion seem, well, you know what I mean? It is being used by people for a source of revolution, isn't it? The internet, in a very clever way.
Yeah, of course. But I mean, I think the point is, you know, the analogy I made to the Industrial Revolution, I think, is important to reintroduce here, because, of course, the Industrial Revolution was not an unclever revolution. It was a very clever revolution, but also the reaction against it. You know, and Romanticism is a very complex area, because, yes, of course, that's also, like, you know, extreme nationalism,
yes,
which is complex. But also there's a kind of, like, you know, like, if you look at, like, William, like a kind of William Morris, like, social emancipation reaction to the Industrial Revolution, that's quite interesting potential. Very nostalgic, but offers quite interesting potentiality. But I think there's a removal to be made between, like tools to be used for a revolution, like all empirical revolutions. I mean, the British Empire was built around the Industrial Revolution, the use of its tools, which is clever and made lots of things. But I think it's important to also separate, like, the production of, like, an aesthetic revolution and how that may relate to people as individuals or groups, and a kind of broader ideological revolution like ISIS and, you know, the internet.
But in a way, are you sort of saying that, because one of the issues about this could be the use of the word romance and its different meanings, the meanings it's taken on completely in popular culture, which is very different from the original romanticism.
Mm. Well, I think romance is also, is different from romanticism. I think it's important to talk about romanticism because, of course, it's like a preeminent aesthetic form that, like, is relatable and became, and has become kind of, has diverged and evolved and become kind of bastardized and became kind of chocolate box. And, you know, like, it has its own kind of history anyway.
Yes, yeah.
And I think, in the, you know, the point of the text is what I'm saying with romance is that I think romance is like a workable, changeable thing, you know, like, so we can, it of course has many changing meanings, and maybe it can be a vehicle to contain something which communicates. So the connection between, say, like, romance as a strategy for engagement and a new romanticism is kind of like how you can convey meaning to people through artworks, like how you make works, particularly if you make works which rely on appropriation so heavily, as I do. The point of doing it, or like the whole rhetoric that exists there, is kind of about engagement. It's about, like, you know, you're here in my show or looking at my work, and we are talking about societal structures, which we're kind of all talking about. Like, we're all kind of, you know, using these things that we've seen before, and we like put them and like we represent them somehow, you know, like, whether that's more like sublime or whatever. So the interest is like, how can we do that effectively in a way that people actually engage with, you know, as opposed to just being either a part of like a kind of quite linear art discourse, or maybe not. I mean, I'm not being negative about an art-centric discourse, but you know, it's quite specific. You know, so like, and when you, you know, when you are outside, I mean, even within the institution, but like, when you are in these kind of bigger institutions, you have so many people that come, people who are not like art specific, not art specialists. And I think it's very important to also think of ways that like those, there can be a discourse which is broad enough to also maybe relate that way.
You know, they don't have a word for love. They only have a name, which is like or to love, and then they have, but they do have a term for falling in love.
You know? What? It's just like, yeah,
I'll let the French people debate that.
They don't have a word for love, do they? As such, I mean, like, well, there's like it, a name, but and then you have coup de foudre for falling in love, don't you? But you don't have, you simply, it's different than in English, the actual language, you know, that implies it's almost got different meaning. You know?
Of course, I mean, there are some different which are literal translations for falling in love in French, which is tomber amoureux, which is as literal as you can imagine. And love is amour, which is like very literal as well, quite straightforward. But of course, you know, you always find like terminologies that are not quite exactly matching in other languages. But I think about love.
The context of the sentence. Like, you don't just say just three words or just say I love you. There's also not three words.
Sorry.
Even on the context,
that's what I'm thinking. Yeah, I take your point. Yeah,
you're not saying that. We are just loving.
I know. Okay.
I just wanted to say, I didn't want to inspire a discussion about how the internet is used as a revolutionary tool. I was thinking about a trajectory of the rise of cities and feeling of anonymity and alienation, and how people feel either connected or alienated.
Yeah.
And that being, this being a kind of reference to it.
Yeah, absolutely. And of course, that's an interesting question, because if we think about nostalgia within this, you know, there was this kind of nostalgia for like return to the country, return, like this kind of, that certainly was like romanticism, nostalgia.
Looking at flowers.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Like, you know, riding around in carts and stuff and pretending you were medieval. So the return is, of course, really important, but, like, I guess, I don't know. I also think that you could probably, in the context of a city, talk equally about, like, the return to community in that sense, because we've lived in the city, like, in comparison to in the Romantic era, the city is now quite this kind of homogenous thing. It's kind of vast and global. And, you know, we are very global. That's the thing. It's more like a, I think, you know. romantic technology.
Thank you.
Thank you.